All right, welcome back inside our proactive newsroom. And joining me now is Richard Williams. He's the CEO of Cornish Metals. And Richard, it's good to see you. How are you?
I'm very good, Steve. Thanks for taking the time.
Yeah, excited to learn a lot more about your company because it's a very interesting and diverse company. We've got a lot of things going on here. But just before we do that, maybe just give everyone a bit of background on the company in general.
Sure. We changed the name of the company last year to Cornish Metals. Our focus is in Cornwall in the UK. And we have two principal assets. One is the old South Crofty tin mine, which was a mine over a 406-year period. For the first 300 years, it was a copper mine. And then between 1905 and 1998, it was a high-grade underground tin mine. So that's really a development project. And we've also got nearby an exploration project we call United Downs, which has some near-surface high-grade copper plus tin plus silver plus zinc mineralization. We've got an ongoing drill program there. And then we also have an agreement with a company called Cornish Lithium, and they're exploring our mineral rights for the lithium potential, lithium in geothermal waters. So there's a lot going on. There's a lot of interest in Cornwall right now, so it's a good time for the company.
Yeah, we'll talk about your two projects you mentioned at the beginning just a second, but there was some news out about the lithium one, and I just thought we'd just cover that off first, and that is that Cornish Lithium has decided to extend the contract with you for another 12 months.
A year. Yeah, so yeah. We reached an agreement with Cornish Lithium way back 2017. They came up with a very interesting idea of exploring Cornwall for lithium in brine or lithium in geothermal waters. And what you have in Cornwall is an extensive granite complex that underlies some old sedimentary rocks. And the granites are enriched in lithium. And they've sat there for the last 270, 280 million years. And you've had this circulation of geothermal groundwaters, which has the potential to leach lithium. So, there's already been a couple of drill holes drilled. There is lithium in the groundwater. And so really it's an endorsement by Cornish Lithium of the potential to find hopefully economic quantities of lithium in the brine. And we've got an extensive land package. And for us, you know, it's a no-brainer of a deal. We get a free carried interest, 25% interest on the first project that goes through to a feasibility study. 10% interest on any subsequent projects, plus a 2% royalty. And then we get the annual share issuances from Cornish Lithium, which we just announced earlier this week.
Yeah, makes a lot of sense. Lithium is obviously very hot right now. A lot of people are talking about that. Also talking about the tin market as well. And as you mentioned, this mine that you have has been around for many, 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 and I can go about 1500 more manys if you want. And tin is obviously what you're looking at there. Can you tell me a bit more about the market for it and where that production is at South Crofty?
Sure. You know, tin has been very much an overlooked and underloved metal for a long time.
Yeah.
But I think the importance of tin to the electronics world and the technology world is really starting to gain some traction in the market. Although there's not a lot of tin used in each electronic appliance, it is used in everything. And so there are billions and billions of circuit boards, you know, you look at the Internet of Things, you look at electric vehicles, renewable power, power storage, robotics, computing, everybody wanting to work from home today. And all of these electronic appliances have tin in them. And the main use for tin today is solder. So anything with an electrical connection has tin in it. And what we've seen over the last, I would say, really, you can go back to 1985. The tin price crashed in 85. And then in 2001, there was a big change in the tin world where lead solder was outlawed and the only suitable replacement was tin. So over the last 20 years, you've seen a lot of the excess supply of tin and any tin that was held in storage in warehouses has basically been consumed. And now you're looking at record low levels of stocks at the LME and at the Shanghai Metals Exchange. And correspondingly, you've now in a situation where the tin price has reached an all-time high. Yesterday, the three-month contract closed at $40,500 per ton.
Wow. A year ago,
it was around $20,000. So, you know, you've seen 100% gain in the tin price. And more importantly, I think there's a growing recognition of things like the security of supply and strategic supply for certain minerals, tin being one of them, to economies like Europe, the UK, North America. And interestingly, there's no domestic tin production in the US. There's only byproduct tin production in Europe. And yet it is ubiquitous throughout the electronics world. So all of these regions around the world, countries that have aspirations to achieve net zero, to grow a renewable power generation base, solar power, wind power, all of these things need tin. And so it's an exciting time, and we've probably got the highest grade tin resource that's certainly outside of Asia, China, that's currently not in production. So it's an excellent project with a long history of mining, and hopefully we can get it back into production.
Do you have a timeline for that yet, or is that something you've talked about publicly?
If everything goes well, we're probably looking at a four-year time horizon to get the mine into production. Okay. It's obviously all subject to financing, like every other project in the resource world. But the advantage we have over, I think, a lot of other projects is from a risk perspective, we know that the ore is mineable. We know that the tin is recoverable. So the geological and mineral processing aspects are very well understood. More importantly, we've got a mine permit that's currently valid. It's valid for another 50 years. We've got planning permission to build a process plant, and we've got the environmental permit as well to go with that. So it's really a case of getting the funding to push the project forward. And I think with tin prices where they are today, I think hopefully there's a good opportunity to achieve that.
Okay. And Richard, one last thing I want to ask you about is just about, you mentioned the United Downs, and that's still a, sort of an exploration project. So tell me quickly a little bit about that one and where you're at.
Yeah, so in 2019, there was a drill hole drilled at United Downs, which went through some high-grade copper and tin mineralization in an area that's, again, got a very long history of mining. The drill hole went through almost 15 meters of 8.5% copper, 1.2% tin, about 100 meters below surface. To the north and south of that drill hole, there were two old high-grade copper mines that have recorded production grades in excess of 7% copper. Mm-hmm. These operated in the 1600s, 1700s, up until about the 1860s, 1870s. To the east, you've got the old Mount Wellington and Wheal Jane mines, which were more polymetallic copper, zinc, tin, silver mines that operated in Wheal Jane's case up until 1991, 92. So we are drilling in that area to hopefully outline a resource that would really complement what we're doing at South Crofty. South Crofty is only 8 kilometers as the crow flies to the west of United Downs. Mm. We've got a drill program currently ongoing at United Downs. So again, you know, we put out some very good intercepts last year, and we hope to continue that this year.
Sounds like it's going to be very busy, that's for sure, Richard. Thanks so much for catching us up today. You got a very rich history of projects, of very interesting stuff. So it's great to see you. Thanks very much, and we'll talk again soon.
Same to you. Thanks, Steve.
All right, there's Richard Williams. He's the CEO of Cornish Metals.